Sri Lanka has 51 acts that deal with water. There are more than 45 agencies that do implementation in the water sector. This has resulted in confusion, duplication, and sometimes inaction, resulting in certain sectors such as the newer emerging sectors such as industries, drinking water being impacted more than the older water sector users such as irrigation and irrigated agriculture. Livelihood needs of rural livelihood needs have been impacted by this by the inability to resolve sectoral and institutional differences between these agencies. A comprehensive law was actually a policy and law was drafted, but has not found favor for implementation due to certain lack of political commitment due to its, shall I say, comprehensiveness. It was too overarching and too comprehensive that resulted in opposition from many sectors in the country. The Sri Lanka Water Partnership has tried to enter into dialogue on certain issues so that the idea of a water policy can be reawakened among the communities and among the politicians. The Sri Lanka Water Partnership has tried as a conscious strategy to reawaken interest in the water policy by using what you call hot topics or hot issues such as city floods, landslides, illicit river sand mining to raise consciousness about the need for a comprehensive water policy. We have found that when such incidents occur, both the communities are alerted and they are very conscious of the impacts, and at the same time the politicians themselves are sensitive to the issues that arise. So it provides an opportunity for us to raise consciousness at various levels to resolve the issue, which is really to have a comprehensive water policy that will ensure proper management of the water resources. Coming to river sand mining has had a severe impact in most of the major rivers, in that by excessive mining the water tables have lowered considerably. Both drinking water supplies and agricultural livelihoods have been affected. When agricultural livelihoods are affected, people have to move to other areas and do sometimes as agricultural labor, or they migrate to other areas because the water supply is not adequate for them to do farming. When water for drinking is not available, the people, especially the women, have an immense problem of having to go very long distance to secure drinking water. Then there are issues of health and sanitation that are connected to lack of and lowering of water tables. So these issues, on the other hand, movement of heavy vehicles have damaged infrastructure and created problems. River bank collapse has impacted on the environment and has widened the rivers, creating problems for the river courses, changing its river course. There have been issues like that. So these have been some of the major problems that have arisen due to river sand mining. Due to agitation by the communities and due to our intervention with the trying to provide a forum for dialogue between the respective relevant agencies and the communities, we have been able to resolve certain issues and bring about better regulation. On one side, we have supported public interest litigation, where certain NGOs have filed action against river sand mining, against the authorities for issuing permits. And we have supported this public interest litigation on that side. Then on the other side, we have mobilized the communities and got them organized And through our area water partnerships, the Sri Lanka Water Partnership has an institutional arrangement called Area Water Partnerships at the local level. These have been mobilized to lobby with the politicians and then request changes. At the same time, the forums we have provided have brought the central authority, central agency people from the center to deal with the issue at the regional and provincial levels. So we have provided, we have upstreamed the issues at the local level right to the center, and they are, this has resulted in certain policy and changes, especially in the environmental laws, and the separate sand mining regulations have been now put in place as to amount of sand that can be extracted, about with regard to transport, regard to the periods on which sand can be extracted. The machinery is now not allowed for river sand mining. Use of heavy machinery is now banned as a consequence from sanding. It has to be done manually. So these have brought in a certain level of reduction in the problem. And some restoration of the water levels and other aspects have taken place, because sand mining, you know, sand is a thing that really river, sand accumulates and then you can restore after 4 or 5 years, you know, the water tables go up, and they have found that in some areas there has been some satisfactory improvements. From our perspective, we feel that many lessons have been learned, and a different approach is necessary for us to be able to have a comprehensive policy on water resources implemented. The earlier policy was all-embracing and too comprehensive, and this resulted in many objections from many sectors and even the general public. We feel that if issues such as the principles on which policy is to be established is clearly articulated first, then a priority on aspects that need to be tackled with respect to water resources are first included in the policy to be addressed, and to work the policy as a step-by-step approach, as part of a continuum, rather than an all-embracing single document would be more appropriate. We envisage having political roundtables to capitalize on the issues of the advantages and the results that have come up from the discussions on the hot topics. This we intend doing in the coming 2 years, where politicians will be sensitized to these issues and requested to discuss this at a wider forum at the central level, because our work has been essentially in the field level at this stage. We feel that if the water policy principles on which the water policy is based and clear priorities are established, comprehensive water policy as a on an incremental basis can be established for this country quite soon, say within the next 2 or 3 years, ultimately culminating in a overarching policy and law, perhaps in 5 or 6 years, by which time we will have a fully integrated policy and law for the management of water resources.